That's Amy Grant just borrowing Joni Mitchell's Big Yellow Taxi. And with that, it's bye-bye from me, and it's good morning from him.
That was a nice record, that.
Lovely, wasn't it?
You begin to play stuff that I like. I'm beginning to get slightly worried.
Second generation, that is.
Where are you going?
I'm not going anywhere.
For 2 weeks?
I'm going on a cruise round my backyard.
No, you're not. You're lying to me. You're just telling me that because you don't want burglars to know that you won't be at home.
You always say that every time I go on holiday.
I always say that because it makes burglars come to your home.
Invite burglars to burglary.
Where are you going?
I'm not going anywhere.
Ach, for God's sake.
Do you honestly believe that if I were going anywhere, I would tell you?
Go on, tell me where you're going.
If I told you where I was going, you would turn up there.
No, I can't turn up. I'm stuck to the last tier.
Just for badness, you would.
I have to stay here. Mm. I'm taking a week off when you come back.
Are you?
I am indeed.
I may have something to say about that.
Go and ask me where I'm going.
Where are you going?
Nowhere.
It's settled then.
I'll tell you what I'm going to do, actually. If the time is right, I'm going to join in the cross-community puma hunting.
Have they not caught that cat yet?
Caught that cat yet? It's hard to say that. Were afraid to say that in case you'd stop.
What, caught that cat yet?
Caught that cat yet. Have they not caught that cat yet?
Sounds like a Russian dancer, Katya Katya.
Katya Katya! It must be the weekend.
Sorry, I lost it there for a
moment. We lost it together.
Mm-hmm.
It's the weekend, of course.
It is indeed.
So you're not going anywhere?
No, I don't.
You're lying.
So.
You're going to Croatia or somewhere.
Croatia.
Everybody's going to Croatia now, aren't they?
Oh, only Jackie Fullerton goes to Croatia when there's a football match on.
Did he go there? No, people are going there on their holidays. Apparently the beaches are lovely and you hardly get shot much.
Are there any of them coming back?
Apparently 10% of them come back.
Have they got pumas in Croatia?
No. This is the only place where both religions hunt them.
Is that right?
Yes, indeed.
Heaven help the poor wildlife.
First it was cross-community shark fishing, then it was cross-community puma hunting. Who knows, maybe perhaps we'll go out socially together.
It's good that we can pull our weight in some direction together, isn't it?
If I would give all I have, John, to bring peace to this community.
Peace of what?
A piece of, you know, whatever it is you have.
Peace of the action.
If we could learn to live together, John, what a wonderful place this would be.
I wouldn't want to live with you.
No, I wouldn't want to live with you either. No. Maybe that's what's wrong. It's a one-to-one. See, we all love each other abstractedly. But once it comes to one-to-one, we can't be bothered.
That's true. I was talking with a woman there about sex in the city.
And what did she got to say? Did she ask you, were you interested?
Yeah, she wrote Sex in the City. Do you ever
Candace Bushnell.
That's her.
Were you talking to her today?
I was, yes. I knew that you had...
Do you want to try that again?
No. I don't think I could make it.
Do you know that Sarah Jessica Parker, who plays her...
Is her double.
Do you know that she's got a home up here in Kilcar?
Has she really?
Yes, she has.
I didn't know that.
In Kilcar, but not beside Glencolum Kill. Do you know the area?
I know Glencolum Kill, yeah.
She has a holiday home up there with her husband, Matthew Broderick. Matthew Broderick's grandfather was from there, and actually there's a hall up there called Broderick Hall.
Is that right?
Mm-hmm. And he came back there as he was a child. Apparently his grandfather and his father brought him back often. He developed a love for the area, so he's bought a little house there, and he's probably there now, him and Jessica Parker. She rings me all the time. She listens to this programme on a regular basis. She turns off when you come on.
That's not what Candace said.
Ah, but Candace doesn't know. I bet you didn't know she had a house in Kilcar, did you?
No, I didn't know she was married to Matthew Broderick.
You see, you know nothing. You're sitting there pompously, thinking that you know everything. But then again, I come along a little skinny quirt, and I know everything.
Little skinny what?
Quirt.
Quirt?
I made that up. I've been reading James Joyce.
It was nearly something else. Be careful. Have a care.
Well, I won't see you for a couple of weeks.
No.
Enjoy yourself, whatever you're doing, wherever you're going, whomever you are with.
Right.
Okay, bye.
Bye.
Bye. I don't care where he goes. Oh, he's still listening. Here's Dana Lyons. All you people who are contemplating cutting your grass next year.
My grandpa was a cowboy, and his pa before him. They rode the range, killed the buffalo, and fought the Indian. But the great herd's on the prairie, and the wild frontier is gone. So to carry on my heritage, I go out and ride the lawn. Ride the lawn, ride the lawn. Here on my quarter acre lot, I sing my freedom song. Ride the lawn, ride the lawn. We'll hunt the dandelion down and whack him till he's gone. My neighbor is a slacker, and he rarely rides the lawn. He says that he likes wildflowers with dew on them at dawn. But the enemy travels quickly when the winds are strong. Next week while he's on vacation, his dandies will be gone. Ride the long,
ride the long,
ride the long,
ride the long.
Here on my quarter acre lot, I sing my freedom song. Ride the long,
ride the long,
ride the long. We'll hunt the dandelion down and whack him till he's gone.
Ride the long.
The problem with suburbia is you cannot shoot your gun. So how does one kill herds of moles who eat grass just for fun? Well, I've loaded up my arsenal with shells and ammo cans, and under cover of the fireworks, July 4th, I'll make my stand. Ride the long,
ride the long,
ride the long,
ride the long.
Here on my quarter acre lot, I sing my freedom song. Ride the long,
ride the long,
ride the long. We'll hunt the dandelion down and whack him till he's gone.
Ride the long.
My son came home from college, and he criticized my lawn. He said fertilizers, herbicides, and pesticides are wrong. Well, I'll listen to your politics and your weirdo leftist songs. But when you're under my roof, don't you dare speak ill of lawns. Ride the lawn,
ride the lawn,
ride the lawn.
Ride the
law. Here on my quarter acre lot, I sing my freedom song. Ride the law.
Ride the law.
Ride the law. We'll hunt the dandelion down and whack him till he's gone.
Ride the law.
You see, when we say lawnmower, we don't mean the ones that you ride on. You see, when Americans and Australians talk about lawnmowers, they think about lawnmowers, they think about little kind of Jeeps. That's good about, but we don't have those. Well, we do have them, but not many of us do. We still use the old-fashioned push variety with a petrol-driven engine. That's Dana Lyons. I keep saying Dana, but I know that's wrong. All kinds of everything. Dana Lyons, that's a new album, which is called Ride the Lawn. That's the first track off it, which is also called Ride the Lawn. You can get that if you, I don't know, I suppose you could get that in any record shop, I suppose, but if you've any trouble and you're interested in that, www.coyswithguns.com or www.danalyons.com. Why do you have to keep saying www.? It's so awful. Anyway, Dana Lyons, he'll be in, he's doing a tour at the moment. He will be in the Errigal Inn in Belfast on Thursday, the 18th of September. And he's coming in here on the Monday or Tuesday that week. I'm not quite sure, the 15th or 16th. So he's coming in to sing a song, which will be nice. That Cows with Guns was a huge, huge hit. Anyway, good morning. Gerald Michael Anderson here. Give us a ring if you wish. The number is 08459 555 678. That's 08459 555 678. You can use an email if you wish. It's jerry.anderson at bbc.com.
www.newsnow.co.uk. Mr. Coyle isn't with us today by public demand. He's gone off to England to celebrate some anniversary or other. I'm sure that is why the rain is raining down. Right, so John Simpson sends me an email and he says, Jerry, where would I obtain a copy of Bob Gurley's Prevention of Accidents book? Oh, that's the best book you've ever read indeed. I have only one copy of it, but I would not lend it to anybody. I have to keep that. It's called The Elimination of Accidents. Bob Gurley, a genius. A man who's written down all the things that no one has ever thought to write down. It's, I don't know where you'd get that. If Bob is listening, Bob, give us a ring here at 08459-555-678. And let us know where we can get your book, because there's a man. I've had a number of requests for that. It's called The Elimination of Accidents. It cannot be got in any normal bookshop, I have to add. Right, and here's a man who says, my name is Joe Mackerel. I am over in Northern Ireland. That's a great name, Joe Mackerel. Oh, it's Mackle, I'm sorry. Hi, Jerry, my name is Joe Mackle. I'm over in Northern Ireland on holiday with my husband, Mal. Oh, Joe as in J-O, but it says J-O-E, me leading me to think that the person was male, but apparently not. I'm with my husband, Mal, from Brisbane, Australia. I have heard a lot about your show from my nephew, Liam, who listens every day on his Walkman, as he is a postman in Belfast. I must say, having listened since Monday, he has good taste. Oh, thank you. You must be on the wrong station. I wonder if you could say hello to all our family in Crumlin and Belfast who have shown us such a good time. Is there any way we could listen to your show in Australia? Well, there is, of course. BBC website, www.bbc.co.uk/Northern Ireland Radio, or whatever it is. If you give us some details. Those are the details. Thank you for your time. Keep up the good work. That's Joe and Mal Mackle. Thank you. Who's that annoying man who keeps interrupting you? Well, he's a gentleman, a little street boy, a little climbing boy we rescued from the chimneys of our city. And he's in here, but not on a regular basis. He's not here today. I'll be able to talk uninterruptedly. And here's a man. Dear Jerry, any chance of an oil plug? Yes, we do oil plugs in this programme. We had over 50 young people working since the second week of July on this challenging show. I don't know what it is. A few bombs, not the lush kind of seats, would be a thrilling end to their summer's work. We'd appreciate it on Thursday, Friday or both. Well, there's an attachment to that, which I don't know. I'm sorry about that. Right, okay, so number to ring if you want to contact the programme. I'll just get that attachment out because it's not fair. 08459-555-678. I'm now going to take an opportunity to play you something that you may not have heard before. The Undertones, as you well know, are one of Derry Stoke Londonderry's seminal pop groups. And they have a new album of all new material. And here's the second track, which is called I Need Your Love The Way It Used To Be. The album is called Get What You Need. It's not out until October 3rd. This is a bit of a preview. This is called I Need Your Love The Way It Used To Be.
Leads to misery. I'm out of the
there's a bit of life about that one, isn't there? That's the undertones. I need your love the way it used to be. Well, you see, that's the next track, but I wasn't expecting that to come up, really. That's the album, the Undertones' new album, not out until October the 3rd. It's called Get What You Need, and that track was called I Need Your Love The Way It Used To Be. I'm going to play a couple more tracks of that today, because that sounds really good. Someone on the line here, I hope. Maybe. Hello, good morning.
Hello, my name's Eddie, Jerry.
Yes, Eddie, did you say?
Eddie Norris.
Okay, Eddie, what can we do for you this fine day? The summer's over, isn't it?
Well, it's getting chilly now, isn't it?
I noticed the rain trickling down my back this morning as I walked my quadruped. Anyway, that's neither here nor there. Let me know what I can do for you.
Okay, I was hoping to just get your assistance to publicise our little charity, trying to help people with energy-saving measures, Jerry.
Energy-saving measures?
Yeah.
In what way can you help?
About it in the summer, with the winter coming in.
Uh-huh.
What we do is we supply energy-saving devices, measures to people's homes for those who are eligible for the scheme.
Yes.
We can supply things which will help them to conserve energy and therefore save money, such as radiator reflector foils and boiler jackets and jug kettles and low-energy light bulbs and things of that nature.
Do they make a difference, those things?
Well, it's been proved that they can make a substantial difference in saving heat escaping from the home, especially measures like loft insulation and cavity wall insulation.
Well, I'm a man who's long been interested in cavity wall insulation. I always say insulation, I know it's wrong. So this is a good time of year to be thinking about that, because it's like when you don't wear a hat, most of the heat goes off the top of your head.
It's exactly right. You can save like 30% of the heat.
That's right.
By cavity wall insulation.
Well, are you helping people to do this? Are you advising people to do this? Or what are you doing?
Well, the way the project works is we've been operating in Down District here for over 2 years, and we've had over 1,000 clients already.
Mm-hmm.
The scheme's in its third year now, but it's got a shelf life, you know, until about the end of March. So at the moment, we're quite anxious to see how many people we can find.
So what do people need to do then to find out all about this stuff?
Okay, the name of the scheme is No Age to Golden Age.
Well, it's No Age to Golden Age?
Yes.
What does that mean?
Well, because some of our clients are parents with children under 5.
Yeah.
And the majority of the clients are people over 60.
I see.
When the scheme was invented, they came up with this name.
So it's for everybody? It's for everybody?
It's for the young to the old, yes.
Okay, right.
Right. They would find out by applying to myself in the Down District, or applying to our head office in Belfast, where there's a similar scheme operating.
So anybody, doesn't matter where you live, they can operate, you can take advantage of this?
The scheme operates in Down District, the one I run, but we've got similar schemes running in Belfast and Coleraine and Newry and Mourne as well.
All right, okay. It's
quite well-spread.
So who do they ring, or what do they do?
Well, in my case, it would be good if they would ring directly to my number here in the Down District Council office.
Yeah. Give us it then, if you don't mind.
Okay, 02844.
Yes.
61 0820. Would you like the numbers of the other schemes while we're...
Okay, I'll have them here if anybody wants them. Yeah, sure.
That'd be great. Okay, well, the Belfast scheme, the number would be 02890.
Yes.
402.
Yeah.
342.
Yeah.
The Coleraine scheme would be 02870.
Yeah.
328.
Yeah.
723.
Yeah.
That would be Corrine Thompson.
Yeah.
And the Newry and Mourne scheme would be 02830.
Yeah.
835.
Yeah. 971. Okay. All right. So I've got those numbers. A Newry number, Coleraine, Belfast, Down.
Yeah, those are the four main areas where we're operating. I'm trying to promote my scheme, obviously, here in Down District, where my partner is Down District Council.
Yes. All right, then. So, okay. Anyone who's interested in that, give those numbers a ring. If you didn't get the numbers, give us a ring. We have them here. Okay, well, thank you very much, sir. Thank you for coming on.
Thank you very much indeed.
That's some useful information for the winter.
Right.
Okay.
My wife will be delighted that I'm speaking to you. She's one of your biggest fans.
Is she? God bless her. What's her name?
Peggy.
Good morning, Peggy.
She's got your autograph, so...
Oh, ho!
My stock will be immeasurably higher at home now.
Very few of that.
Okay, then.
Okay, thanks very much. Thank you. Notice the dexterity with which I wrote down those phone numbers. I didn't have to say at any time, what was that again? This is because, not a lot of people know this, but I used to be registered on the dole as a routine clerk. I was a routine clerk for like 3-4 years, and my card may still be on the dole. I was on the dole until I was 40, until the BBC found me. But if there's a brew clerk out there who's got access to the files, little cards you to pull out when you just come up and sign, you can bring mine out, and it will say, routine clerk. It's not everyone reaches the heights of routine clerk, and I haven't lost the skills. I notice it. Look at that. Give me a phone number. I never have to ask you twice. A lot of requests for this. I played this the other day. It's Bob Dylan, Nobody's Child.
I was slowly passing an orphan's home today. I stopped for just a little while to watch the children play. Alone, the boy standing, and when I asked him why, he turned with eyes that could not see, and he began to cry. I'm nobody's child. I'm nobody's child. Just like a flower, I'm growing wild. No mama's arms to hold me, no daddy. Places just like this, with rows and rows of children, babies in their cribs. They've long since stopped the crying, as no one ever hears, and no one's there to notice them or take away the fears. Nobody's child. Nobody's child. Just like a flower, they're growing wild.
Got no mommy's kisses and no daddy's smile. Nobody wants them there.
To be had out there. eyes are like starlight now.
To break the spell,
I'll take your hat. Your hair looks red.
I ought to say no, no.
Mind
no,
if I move in closer?
At least I'm gonna say that I tried.
What's the sense of hurting my pride?
I really can't stay.
Baby, don't hold out.
Ah, but it's cold outside. I simply must go.
Betty, it's cold outside.
The answer is no.
I say it's cold out there.
The welcome has been.
How lucky that you dropped in.
So nice and warm.
Look out that window. Man, that's
my warm. Sister will be suspicious. Gosh,
your lips look delicious.
My brother will be there at the door.
Waves upon a tropical shore.
My maiden aunt's mind is vicious.
Your lips are delicious.
Well, maybe just a cigarette more.
Never such a blizzard before.
I've got to go home.
Better you freeze out there.
Say, lend me your comb.
It's up to your knees out there. I thrill when you touch my hand.
But don't you see?
How can you do this thing to me?
There's bound to be tough to
think of my lifelong sorrow.
At least there will be plenty implied.
If you caught pneumonia and died,
I really can't stay.
Get over that old now.
Ah, oh, that's great. That's the latest single from Sinead Quinn and Malachy Cush. Good to see them. Jerry asks, Quirt is a small riding crop or whip for battering, encouraging a horse to get more oomph out of him at vital moments in a race and to explain things to him when he's been trained. Thank you very much for that. That's the Undertones, you can't say that. That's from a new album, Get What You Need, as I said, out on October 3rd. We'll be back out.
92 to 95 FM.
And 1341 medium wave.
BBC Radio Ulster.
It's 11 o'clock. This is the news with Linda Ray. A man has appeared in court in connection with a fatal accident in Carnlough in County Antrim last month in which two teenagers died. Maggie Swarbrick reports from the court in Larne.
32-year-old Paul Jude Johnston of Ballymena Road in Carnlough has been charged with two counts of causing death by dangerous driving. 15-year-old David McCauley from Seacourt Road in Larne and 16-year-old Gavin O'Neill from Carnlough died in the accident on the 27th of August. The teenagers were backseat passengers in the car when it crashed into a garage. Paul Johnston is also charged with driving while unfit through drink or drugs. The court heard that when he was charged, he made no reply. He was remanded on bail to appear in court again on October the 31st.
The murder of a 10-year-old boy 30 years ago in Belfast is to be reinvestigated by the police. Brian McDermott disappeared from a playground in the city in 1973. Conor McCauley reports.
Brian McDermott's mutilated body was recovered from the River Laggan a week after his disappearance in September 1973. He'd been abducted from a playground in Ormo Park. The police said today that they were appealing for fresh information about the killing. Detective Chief Inspector George Hamilton said he was hopeful the culprit could still be caught. He acknowledged that it would be difficult to jog people's memories after so many years, but the case, he said, had never been closed. He said even the smallest snippet of information might open up a new line of inquiry or add to the information already available. It's possible, Mr. Hamilton said, that someone who didn't volunteer information at the time might now be prepared to contact police anonymously using the confidential Crime Stoppers number.
The Ulster Unionist leader David Trimble has said that the so-called Dream Team leadership of Sir Reg MP and Geoffrey Donaldson is not a viable option. Speaking on RTE Radio this morning, he said those who tout the Dream Team tend to find it shriveled up when brought into the light of day. Mr. Trimble said that if commentators choose to portray this weekend's meeting of the Ulster Unionist Council as his last stand, he will take great pleasure in proving them wrong. Police have arrested a man in connection with the rape of a 15-year-old girl by a man she met through text messaging. He's due to be questioned by Greater Manchester Police later today. Lisa Hempley reports.
The girl from Wigan says she'd met her attacker through an internet chat room. Another teenager using the site had passed on her mobile phone number and the man had been texting her for a month. She says they met in Wigan town centre on Monday and 2 hours later he raped her in daylight behind the town's Means Park. Greater Manchester Police say a man aged 25 has now been arrested and is being held on suspicion of carrying out the rape. He's due to be questioned by detectives later today.
A three-bedroom semi, along with a giant model railway covering the back garden, is up for sale near Blackpool. It has 600 feet of track, as well as tunnels, bridges and stations. The owner, Gordon Archer, is emigrating to Australia and is hoping that a fellow model railway enthusiast will buy his property. And the weather, rain clearing from the west later today. And the maximum temperature today should reach 18 degrees Celsius. BBC Radio Ulster News.
BBC Radio Ulster.
Travel news.
In Banbridge, construction work continues to the new flyover. As a result, there are diversions via the B25 Catesbridge and A50 Castle Welland roads. Also, there's one-way systems in place on the Ballydon and Lisnaree roads. In Belfast, there are major roadworks on the M1 from Stockman's Lane. A contraflow system's in place and motorists leaving Belfast are reminded that by taking the outside lane at Broadway, they cannot leave the motorway until Lisburn. The inside lane will allow motorists to exit at Stockman's Lane and Blacks Road. Deirdre Harshall reporting.
Travel news from BBC Radio Ulster.
Oh, thank you. Sorry, I'm just manhandling the mic there in case you wondered what that thud was. It's coming up to, it's just coming up to 4 minutes and 30 seconds past 11 o'clock. Just now. Right. The number to ring if you want to contact this program is 08459 555 678. Or if you want to send me an email if you wish, by all means, it's quicker. Jerry.Anderson at BBC. rock.co.uk. A lot of people wanted to know what those last two songs I played, what they were before I played that Undertone single. Well, I played them back to back, I think. Did I? I don't know if I did or not. Well, one of them was, of course, Bob Dylan singing Nobody's Child. You may have been surprised to hear that, but I played that the other week. That was from an album which he did with the Travelling Wilburys. So if you're looking for that, it's on one of the Travelling Wilburys album. I don't know which one. Bob Dylan, Nobody's Child. The other one was a song called Baby It's Cold Outside, sung by Ray Charles and a lady who he identified as Betty, and it turns out that it is indeed jazz singer Betty Carter. It's Ray Charles, Baby It's Cold Outside, accompanied by Betty Carter. That's from an album which is out at the moment, which is the definitive Ray Charles, which is two albums, well, about 46 tracks of some of the best music you'll ever hear in your life. And that's all I have to say about that. Here's a song I haven't played for a very long time. Mickey McConnell's a songwriter and a singer who's extremely talented. And he's doing a short tour at the moment. I just thought I'd play this, and I'll find out later on when you can hear him. This is a song called The Lamb Begged Drummer. It's from his album, which is called Joined Up Writing. It's a lovely song, lovely singer, great songwriter. One of our major talents, of course, from the Republic of Ireland. He's not one of us. No, no. One of their major talents. No, him.
I met her on a far Greek isle. Our accents Irish, a glance, a smile. This girl I could not love at home, loved in Greece and later Rome. On true France and the dust of Spain, Christ, I'll never love like that again. All through that long grape-picking summer, now she's the wife of a lamb-beg drummer. And she touched my cheek in Brittany. What a shame you're Mick, not Sam, said she. Or Stuart, Cecil, Ian, Rob, or Billy, Ivan, Jack or Bob. You're locked inside some fiend dream. You long for things that might have been. But let's not waste what's left of summer before I wed my lamb-beg drummer. I'd watch her while she'd sleep, from firelight soft to shadow deep, and I'd wonder why a cupid's dart must miss the head to wound the heart. And I knew it all too soon would end, two hearts not lost just out on land. And one day I'd reclaim mine from her and set hers free for her lamb-beg drummer. And we wandered a deserted beach. Though I held her hand, she was out of reach. Side by side, but both alone, as we thought about the news from home. And I knew 'twas time for letting go of this sweet and most beloved foe. For her ears were tuned to a tribal thunder called her home to her lamb-beg drummer. In a drab Dutch town we said goodbye. I had to hitch, she chose to fly. 'Twas only as she turned to go that I told her what she had to know. That had she been Mary, Breach or Kate, we'd have walked together out the airport gate. And I'd never more be parted from her by time or tide or a lamb-beg drummer. And I watched the Orange 12th parade. I was half impressed and half dismayed. And there I saw the girl I loved, all hatted, sashed, bemedaled, gloved, more lovely than she'd ever been. When And she was orange and I was green. Her love outblazed a Spanish summer that squandered now on a lambeg drummer. And had she been Mary Breed or Kate, we'd have walked together out the airport gate, and I'd never more be parted from her by time or tide or a lambeg drummer.
There we are. It still goes on, taking down Tyrone flags from fire stations. What are we like, anyway? Cross-community puma hunting notwithstanding. I was wrong, of course, about Mickey McConnell. I said he wasn't one of us. He is. Of course he is. He's from Ballinalech in County Fermanagh. Hello, Lost. Oh, by the way, that's an album which is very good. It's called Joined Up Writing. As I said, when I have details of what gigs he's doing, I'll let you know. I should have had them down with me, but of course, not being a bit organised, I didn't have them with me. Lost and found. Lost a black cat at Marble Hill Caravan Park in Donegal last Friday. We've had a number of complaints that we are not dealing with lost cats and lost dogs. Believe me, we are. We are the only programme on radio also that cares. George does birds. Hugo, what does Hugo do? Hugo said he looks after something. George looks after birds, exotic birds. George does, Hugo, I don't know what, Hugo does vermin, does he? No. Is it John does the vermin? Well, we do everything else. Black cat at Marble Hill Caravan Park lost last Saturday. Hey, where can it go? You know what I mean? Can I give CD details of Nobody's Child? Well, I did that. Well, as far as I know, it's on one of the Travelling Wilburys albums or CDs. I think there was only three of them. So you can check that out on your website or whatever. Even go into your record shop and thumb through the racks. There's an idea. Nobody's done that for years. Angela in Plymouth wants someone to tape tonight's Dumphy show for... Isn't that great what's going on? I don't know if you're following that or not, but there's great stuff going on down below in Dublin. Pat Kenny talk show coming on tonight, Late Late Show, and Eamon Dunphy is coming on as well, TV3, and what a battle of the giants that'll be. It's personal, I think. I'm sure it's personal. I heard some great stuff about that last week, but I'm not allowed to talk about anything. It's interesting in this programme. You're not allowed to talk about in media matters, but it's great. And Country Cool is on tonight at 8:30, of course. Four hopefuls, it says here. Looking for a record contract. So there's Country Cool on BBC One. There's the Late Late Show, The Battle Between the Giants, although anyone who calls Pat Kenny and Eamon Dunphy a giant doesn't go out much. Pat Kenny, Late Late Show, at 11 o'clock. Half nine. And then The Dunphy Show. I personally think that... I'm not going to say what I personally think because I don't want to annoy people or get sacked. Hello, Hugh McGrory of 106 Circular Road. I do believe that's Derry's Roglondon. Happy birthday to him from his brother, I was going to say Marvin, but nobody's called Marvin in Derry, so I realise that he is called Martin. Hello to Elsie Patterson. Happy birthday to her from her sister Nora. No trouble with the names there. Someone on the line here. Hello, good morning. I was talking to Geraldine earlier on and she said there's someone on the line and I was expecting someone else and I said, who is it? She said, no, it's just an ordinary person. Hello, ordinary person.
Good morning.
You're an ordinary person. That's what Geraldine said.
No rumour has it.
No, I was expecting somebody else. And I said, is that so-and-so? She said, no, it's just an ordinary person.
It's your lucky day then, eh?
But hey, you know, there are people. There are people who would pay millions to be an ordinary person.
Like, that's true.
You know, people like I don't know who. No, I can't think of anybody offhand. That's why they're all going on Fame Academy.
That's true. Let's cut to the chase here, Jay.
All right, I'm sorry. I'm doodling about. Right, yeah, go ahead.
Well, it's your money you're wasting here.
All right.
I want to ask you about that Travelling Wilburys song, right? Now I've got the both albums.
There's three of them.
No, there's only two of them.
There's three.
No, there isn't.
Are you sure?
Yes.
I know
there was, the second album was named Volume 3, but they didn't make a Volume 2.
Well, that's... They certainly fooled me. Because when you see Volume 3, you assume there's going to be two before that.
No, no, I got the both of them when I was in Canada, and there was no middle volume.
That's so there's Volume 1 and Volume 3?
Just to confuse the ignorant, you know.
Why on earth... Well, that includes me amongst that category. Well, why did they do a thing like that?
The thing is, Jerry, that was released as a single, I believe.
Oh, was it?
I think it was either for Romanian Children's Appeal or something.
Yeah, yeah.
And I've been trying to get it for years, and I find it anywhere. How did you get a hold of it? Somebody drop it in with you?
Yeah, they did, actually. See, oh, that's the way I get a hold of most things. So right. I'm essentially a very lazy person. See, because yeah. I never... You know all this downloading stuff?
Yes, yes.
I never do that.
Right.
But there's a fellow called Trevor Williams who's very, very good, and he downloads everything for me and he sends me stuff. And he's an expert, and he seems to know what I like. And so other people...
If I look that up on the internet, maybe under Travon Wilburys, maybe it'll give me a clue there somewhere about that.
I don't know, you know. Or even better, why don't you tape this program?
I'm in the middle of a garden right now, so it's difficult to tape.
Mm. Well, I could send you a copy of that, you know.
That would be lovely.
Do you have a wee mini-disc thing?
Yes.
Do you?
Yes.
Do you have that?
Yes.
I'll stick that on for you.
Good man.
I will, actually. I'll just do... I'll tell you what I'll do. What'll I do? I don't know what I'll do.
If it's hanging like the stuff you send to Jordy, I'll never see it.
No, don't be like that. Don't judge me.
I'm only joking.
Who do you think? Don't be St. Peter. Don't judge me before... I'll tell you what I will do. If there's nothing special... See, we tape this program every day.
Right.
And, we tape it because there might be something good on it. But there never is.
No, it's quite good, quite
so
good.
So, we have to use two mini-discs. You see, we use a mini-disc for the first half hour, and then we use another mini-disc for the second half hour.
Right.
So what I will do, I know there was nothing any good on the first half hour of our programme today, so I'll send you that. So what, you'll have a tape of the programme. And right. a clean tape of Nobody's Child.
Excellent.
Eh? So that'll keep you going.
Geraldine, you
give your address to Geraldine there.
Right.
And she has got the tape in her hot little hand at the moment, actually. All you do is pop in an envelope and send it to you.
Excellent, Jerry. I appreciate that. Enjoy your show and outstanding music.
Thank you. Excuse me a second.
Yes?
There was a third album, apparently, called The Best Of. Hold on a minute. There was a third album called The Best Of, apparently.
I don't believe it.
I'll check it anyway. Anyway, no, but that's what they say. There was a third album called The Best of Wilburys. Maybe that was... No, but you say there was Volume 3.
Yes.
There was Volume 1 and Volume 3, but why would they make Volume 2 The Best of Wilburys?
Why do they call themselves The Travelling Wilburys?
The Travelling Wilburys. Why do they call themselves that at all?
Yeah? Mm-hmm.
I don't know. All right, then, well, we'll
tell
send
me, Jerry,
you...
Yeah? Your time you spent in Canada, do you remember a club called the Cock Door?
I used to play in it.
Is that right?
Yeah.
I used to live in Canada.
In Toronto, in Yonge Street, yeah.
Yonge Street, yes.
I played about two gigs there, and then we moved down to a place called the Nickelodeon, which was on Yonge and Dundas.
Nickelodeon, yes.
Remember that? It was a jazz club, and it was in the first floor? It was something on the three floors. The first floor was kind of a, I don't know what it was, and the second floor was a rock club, and the third floor was a massage parlor.
Yeah, well,
and do you know what I used to do?
Covered in them.
Do you know what I used to do? I'm just thinking about this now. You see, we used to play there six nights a week, Monday to this Canadian band I was with. And we were kind of resident there. You see, we played Monday to Saturday.
Right.
And you played five half-hour sets a night between 9 and 1. So you played half an hour, and then you're off half an hour. Then you played half an hour, and then you're off half an hour. You know the way it goes.
Mm-hmm.
And you do that six nights a week. And you get to the stage where the playing's all right, but... You get fed up talking to people. And
yes.
So what you're asked to do by the management, you're asked to, what they say, work the room.
Mingle the customers.
Work the room. What you do is when you get off and you go down, you go down to the table, you say, hello, are you enjoying yourself? That's wonderful. And then they say, do you like a wee drink? I'd love to have a drink. And then you sit down, but you can't drink, you say, because you can't, if you'd be full. So you can't, so you'd say, I'd love to have one later, but I wouldn't mind having a little chat. So you sit down, you talk to them, and they tell you all about themselves, and then you're fed up. So I used to get fed up with that, you see, and I used to say, my God, I have to get out of here. So you couldn't go down, you see, the stairs, because they would see you going out. Do you know what I'm saying?
Right.
The manager
would
see you going out. The only place you could, there was a wee back stairs, the only place you could go was up.
Right.
You know what I'm trying to say? So, and I discovered that all the girls, all the topless girls, the masseuses, they had a little room where they all sat around talking.
Right.
And having coffee, you know, in between customers.
Right.
And I used to go up there and I used to sit with them.
And the first couple of days was awkward, you know? And I'd say, girls, you don't mind if I sit in here and have a cup of coffee? You know, you just do whatever you hope. I won't be in the way or anything. But they're always quite nervous because they think you're going to hit on them. Do you know what I mean? I think you're going to ask. You know what I mean? But yeah, then I said, girls, you know, I work here too. You know, don't worry about me. I'm just, you know, I'm just fed up talking to people. I just let me sit here and read the paper, and you know, and I won't bother you. So I just kept going up there every once in a while, and gradually they were sitting there. You know, they were half naked. They didn't mind that, you know, because I worked there too. They were a bit nervous at the start, but then they realised that I wasn't going to bother them. So they didn't bother about me. And then after about a week or so, I started to talk to them. So I became one of the girls. And I'll tell you what, you learn more about men when you're sitting in a room surrounded by 10 girls who are topless, who are talking about men, talking about their customers. And you look out the door, you see a man will be walking past with a towel around his waist, and he's going, "What about you, kid? You all right?" And they used to look at you, and then they'd run down the hall. And they used to tell you, they told me things that I couldn't repeat. They told me things that I would never have imagined in a million years. They told me things about men that I'd never knew. And see, after about 6 months of that, I could have passed a university degree course. They knew everything. And some of those girls were lovely. And actually, you know, a very dodgy job, because one of the girls that I particularly liked, she was a girl from the Caribbean. She was from Trinidad and Tobago. Lovely girl, copper-coloured, beautiful. And she was telling me that she was having this trouble with this guy. He came in all the time, and she didn't want to really talk to him anymore. But the management wouldn't listen to him. And he said, "That's your job, you know, don't worry about him. You know, whenever he asks for you, you go in." This guy used to ask for her all the time. He used to give her a hard time. He'd say, not abused or anything, but just, you know, say things to her, you know, because those right. girls, you know. And anyway, one day, he waited for her and stabbed her.
My goodness.
That's a fact. But she was okay. She came back about 6 months later, not to work. She came back to say cheerio to the girls and me. And she said, "I don't think I'll do this anymore." And I said, you're absolutely right. So it's great to get the other side. That's why, you know, you wouldn't catch Mark Carruthers doing that.
No.
Eh? Eh? Can't see John Bennett sitting. You can't see him doing that. Or you can see Hugo doing it. Anyway, so why am I telling you all this?
I wonder.
What are we talking about? Oh, yes.
Another quick question for you.
Yes.
Remember the Elma Combo? Did you ever play there?
No, but I know of it. I remember there was a fine, one of the best jazz trumpet players in the world, Dizzy Gillespie. Did you ever hear of him?
Oh, yes, yes.
There was a place down the street, I think it was called The Colony.
Yes, yes.
There was called Colony. And I remember...
The Colonial.
The Colonial, that's it. The Colonial right. Tavern.
Oh, yes. Many the jug had in there.
What a great place that was.
Oh, excellent.
I remember working out that I could have time to run down and see him. I'd only see him for about 10 minutes, see? So I remember making the effort and running down to see him. And I got to the club, and this guy opened the door. This guy was just going out as I was coming in. And it was him. He opened the door and said, "After you, Ben." And I said, "I'm just coming to see you." So I'm just leaving. But I eventually saw him later. Anyway, listen, give your address to Geraldine.
Yes,
and we'll send you the first half of the show, in which is included Nobody's Child.
Excellent, Jerry.
All right, then.
Appreciate that. Enjoy your show. Keep up the good work.
Bye. 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 See, I started to talk to that man there. I started to tell him things about, you know, my life. I better stop doing that. Meet the wrong person. Hello, good morning.
Hello.
Hello. Are you an ordinary person too?
I am, Jerry. I'm trying to trace an album. It's an old album, and I hope you can help me. It's EMI that brought it out, but I can't write to them because I can't remember the name of the album.
That's all right.
It was David McWilliams, the late David.
Yes.
He used to be a friend of mine, and the co-writer of this album, Ted O'Neill, was my boyfriend, you know.
Oh, yes.
Now, the reason I'd love a copy of it is because I did the artwork for The Inside Sleeve.
Oh, dear.
It was a portrait of David in a cowboy hat.
Oh, my God.
And I've lost my copy of it long ago. It would have been done probably in the mid-70s.
Was it called Working for the Government?
No, that wasn't the one, no.
It's only one I have.
I can only remember some of the tracks that were on it, you know.
Well, tell me what the tracks were on.
Well, there was one, Love Walked In.
Yeah.
Another one, Don't Drink the Water.
Don't Drink the Water.
Money Can't Buy You Everything.
Money Can't Buy You.
Joanne. Yeah. Four of them. There was a lot more, but I'd just love a copy of it again, you know.
Well, I'm sure that many people out there do have a copy of that, yeah. And I'm sure that one or two of them will actually, you know, give it to you.
Well, gosh, pay for it, whatever, I don't care.
Oh, either. Okay. So it was David McWilliams and an album which you can't remember the name of.
It was EMI. Found it out, and he co-wrote it with Ted O'Neill.
He co-wrote it with Ted O'Neill.
Ted
and songs like
Chips away a long time ago, an age ago.
Chips?
Yeah, do you remember Chip, the band?
Of course
Chip?
I do. Well, Linda Martin was with Chips.
Yeah, Linda and Paul. And
Linda Martin,
David.
You see her now at the Eurostar and all
yeah,
that kind of rubbish.
On RTE a lot.
How they have fallen. Love Walked In, songs like Money Can't Buy You Everything.
Yeah,
those
are
just a couple
of. Don't Drink
the Water. Don't Drink the Water.
Joanne.
Okay. Well, and you did the artwork.
Okay, it was just, I did a portrait of him from a photograph, and it was on the inside sleeve, you know. And I've lost a copy of it, and I just like it, you know, now that they've
gone. Oh, yeah, of course, yeah.
It would be for sentimental reasons, because I knew him quite well.
They had a little do for David down in the, not for David's, for David's people down in the Errigal Inn a couple of months after he died. You didn't happen to get to that, did you?
I didn't. I live in Bangor, Jerry, and I live with my elderly parents.
Sure, I live in Derry, and I was there.
Well, I have an awful lot more commitments than you.
We've got your copy of that, by the way.
You have not.
Yes, you have.
Thank goodness.
Is that the Joe Trainer that I know? Is that the Joe Trainer that I know? Well, now that's a coincidence. There's a chap called Joe Trainer.
Yeah.
He's a drummer.
Uh-huh.
And I know him extremely well.
Yes.
And I know him from a long time ago, and he's just rung up and says that he has got a copy of that.
Oh, that was quick. That was fantastic.
And you can trust him because he's not like the rest of them. He's okay. You can talk to him without any... I can guarantee his character.
Well, can I contact him, Geraldine?
What do we do, Geraldine? Will you give what... you talk to Geraldine and sort it out in a minute.
Right, Jerry.
So you've got it?
Oh, that's brilliant.
Okay. If I was George Jones now, I'd gloat. But I won't.
Okay. I knew you'd be able to do it, Geraldine.
Aren't I wonderful?
You're brilliant.
Go on, tell me how wonderful I am.
Okay, you're fantastic.
I'm being George now. Go on, tell me again. Tell me how wonderful
you've
I am.
You've made my day. Just talking to you.
And I'm doing all this for no money. I'm doing it for charity. Go on, tell me what I'm doing it for. I'm doing it for charity, aren't I? Am I doing it for charity? Am I great? Am I wonderful? Am I a wonderful person?
Jerry.
Am I an ordinary person, just like a working class person?
That's enough now. That's
all right.
Enough.
Okay. All right then. Bye.
Bye.
Bye. I'm horrible. Siobhan Pellett is a fine singer. He's got a new album out now, which is called Long Ago Tomorrow. It's going to be out on Monday the 6th of October. This is her singing Walk On By. She's a great singer. I'll tell you more after.
If you see me walking down the street and I start to cry each time we meet, walk on. Walk on by.
There we are. That's Siobhan Pettit. What a nice album that is. That's a song called Walk On By, Burt Bacharach, of course. The album is centred on the music of Burt Bacharach. The album's called Long Ago Tomorrow. Siobhan, she's lived and worked in Dublin, London, Paris, New York. She's been about a bit, and she's been based in Belfast for the past 10 years. And she's married to some chap. I can't remember who it is, a gentleman I know. His name's off the tip of my tongue. And Siobhan and her 9-piece band will be performing live at Queen's Festival, which is coming up soon. You probably saw Siobhan quite often. You see her all the time. She does a little backing vocals every now and again, but you see, in her own right, she's fantastic. Anyway, Billy, who lives in Carrickfergus and who will be 41 years married on the 15th of September. There we go. That's from his wife. Doris is obviously relieved to get 41 years in. A caller would like to know where she could get a copy of Conal Gallen's Granny Lap Dancer of the Shooting Star Hotel. Caller would like to know who sang Ride the Lawn, played today on the programme, and any other details about it. Well, a number of people have rung up about that. It's a new album from Dana Lyons. Dana Lyons, who, as you probably know if you're a regular listener to this programme, also recorded Cows with Guns. It's his new album, and I don't know how available it is here, but all I know is that you can get it through his website, which is www.danalyons.com. And he's doing a gig in here in the Errigal Hotel. He's a very nice guy, American guy, wears a cowboy hat, talks like that. He was in here before, but he's coming in here again to this programme on the 15th or 16th of September. And he's got a gig in the Errigal Hotel, which is on the 18th, Thursday the 18th of September. So go along and see him. He's a very friendly guy. If you talk to him, you'll never get rid of him. But then again, that's all right. Hello, good morning.
Hi.
Pam Brighton, is it?
It is indeed,
Joe. Pam, how are you?
I'm okay.
Pam, what are you up to? I believe you're out. You're up very early this morning.
It's my first morning off, but I don't know how long, Joe.
Well, you see, you make the mistake of whenever you have a morning off, you sleep. You see, what happens is this makes you discontent. What you should do whenever you get a morning off, get up earlier than you get up and just sit there and do nothing. And be aware of what's going on around you.
Hmm.
Pam, what are you involved in these days?
We've just done a play called Black Taxi. About the sort of history. It's when you say history, it sounds very dull, but it's not. It's the story of the black taxis in West Belfast. And it started a tour last night.
Where did you start?
Gorton and Mona in West Belfast.
Yes.
And it's in Conway Mill for two nights tonight. It's in Derry for two nights next week on Thursday.
Where's it going to be? The Playhouse or where is it?
No, it's in the Gas Yard.
Oh, great. Oh, that's a very nice place.
I haven't been to it at all.
Oh, yes, you like that.
Mm.
So there for two nights next week. And where is it to, for instance, where did you say you started last night?
Gorton and Mona.
Gorton and Mona. Is it there tonight?
No, it's in Conway Mill.
Conway Mill. You're moving about a bit.
And tomorrow night, and it's in Dungiven on Sunday night.
Yeah. A lot of people are interested in black taxi because, especially those people who live in cities. I mean, I don't know if there's black taxis in places like Lisburn or Lurgan, but they certainly are here in Derry / Londonderry and in Belfast.
Yeah.
And a lot of mythology attached to that. A lot of kind of, a lot of shady stuff.
Well, there is, yeah. I mean, the black taxis are... No, someone called them the best transport infrastructure in Europe.
Well, they're all right if you don't mind a child's lollipop sticking to your cheek.
That's right. But I think some of us don't, Joe. But, I mean, they are an incredible, incredible transport system, that was devised here, created here. And, they are kind of... that for people who know about transport, they're an incredible kind of thing.
Yeah. Well, they'd lift you wherever you were.
Mm.
Well, whether they'd let you out or not is another matter. And also, I used to think it would have helped if the taxis had been insured.
Well, that was a problem.
But, it was a problem.
Yeah. I mean, it wasn't a problem the taxi drivers making. I mean, there was incredible attempts to stop them being insured.
That's right, yeah.
Mm.
Oh, I know about that, yeah. Mm. And have they morphed into something else now?
Oh, they've morphed into what is an amazing transport system.
Yeah.
It's cheap, it's reliable, I think it's been a real kind of... I mean, it's a story about persistence and imagination, really.
Uh-huh.
It was a kind of real invention.
Uh-huh. Well, it was something that was required. It just popped up because it was, the men were there.
Yeah.
And the opportunity was there, and, you know, whatever you thought of it at the time, it was a bit dodgy at the start, wasn't it? I don't know what it's like now. I don't want to castigate men, but it was a bit dodgy at the start.
Well, I think it was, but I don't think it was the driver's making that made it dodgy.
Oh, no, but there was a dodgy air to it.
Yes, yeah, there was. And it was, I mean, it was also, there was a lot of kind of black propaganda about taxis.
That's right, yeah.
You know, that they were not liked by kind of professional transport people. They were not liked by the British government.
Mm.
And they had a hard time, you know, surviving, really.
The only people who liked them were the people who wanted to get from A to B.
Exactly.
And they were unimportant because they were just the public.
Absolutely.
And they used to just throw everybody in, didn't they? I remember being in a black taxi with children sitting on my knee and I didn't know who they were.
Absolutely. No, I mean, it's kind of... I mean, people, you know, every time we do it, people come up with, you know, their own black taxi stories. Yeah. I mean, there's a certain kind of regret, you know, that they're now more civilised and kind of controlled. I think people quite like that kind of wildness of them.
Well, it was like, you know what it's like in the London Tube. If you speak to somebody, they call a policeman.
Yeah.
And the same on the buses. You can't speak to people anymore, but in the taxis, people just sit and chat it.
Yeah, yeah.
Because, you know, for some reason, you had to speak to the person beside you.
Yeah.
You wouldn't just sit in and not speak.
Yeah.
You'd say, well, what about you, love? How's it going? You know, and you're chatting away.
Yeah.
And that's a lovely wee fella there. What's how old is he?
Yeah.
All that kind of stuff. I used to kind of like it in a way.
No, I think that's all. I mean, there's very few kind of times we have that sort of enforced intimacy, isn't
it? That's right, yeah.
And well, I think people quite enjoy it.
They do. And now tell me about the play. Who's in it and who wrote it? And
Brian Moore wrote it.
Oh, for God's sake.
You know, who wrote Paddy on the Road, and it's incredibly funny.
Is that's the chap who did the Christy Murray thing?
That's right, yeah.
He's very, very good. No, I haven't seen him, but I hear amazing reports about him as an actor, and especially...
No, this is the guy who wrote him.
Oh, I'm sorry.
It's all right.
He wrote that.
It's a guy called Brian Moore.
Am I mixing him up with the guy who performed that?
Yes.
Am I? Who was the guy who performed it?
Terry O'Neill.
Sorry. Yes. I apologise to Terry. I'm getting mixed up here.
Right.
But he wrote the Christy Moore thing.
That's right, yeah.
Well, I heard great reports about it. Also reports, obviously, when people are saying how good Terry O'Neill was, they're obviously saying how good the material was.
Yeah.
Said he, trying to wriggle out of his mistake.
No, that's okay. And Jim Doran, he did Des and quite a few plays with us. Is doing it, and another actor called Mark O'Shea.
All right. Well, that sounds interesting. Did you direct it?
Yeah.
Good. Well, you're a good director. So it's going to be good anyway. If you have anything to do with it, because you have a startling pedigree. Okay, Pam. So where do you encourage the people to go now? Just tail off there and tell us where we can see it again.
Right. Well, it's Conway Mill tonight and tomorrow night.
Yeah.
St. Canice's Hall in Dungiven on Sunday.
St. Canice's, yeah.
It's the Roddy McCauley's Club in West Belfast on Tuesday. It's the Gavahi Road Community Centre on Wednesday. It's the Gas Yard in Derry on Friday and Saturday. It's Sarsfields in West Belfast on Sunday. I think that's as far as I know.
Well, I'll tell you what, you're fairly hopping about.
Yep.
Well, good luck to you.
Anyway, it's going to America for a week.
Oh, what'll he make of it there?
I don't know. I don't know if we're not going to have someone at the side of the stage explaining it.
That could well be off-Broadway. Okay, Pam, nice to speak to you again.
Okay, Derek.
Best of luck with that.
And you.
Bye.
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 In the heat of the night, seems like a cold sweat creeping across my brow.
I got the motive, which is money, and the body, which is dead.
In the heat of night, I'm feeling motherless from the skies all mean and bright. In the heat of the night, ain't a woman yet been born, knows how to make the most
sell my soul for just a little light
in the heat of the night.
In the heat of the night. I I've got troubles wall to wall. Oh, yes, I am. I repeat in the night. Must be an ending to it all. But hold on, it won't be long. Just you be strong, and it'll be all.
Best singer ever. That's Ray Charles. It's time for a Ray Charles revival. Why don't we bring him back? You're bringing back everybody else. Why not him? He was the best. Him and Nina Simone. And I wonder, did they ever record together? Did they? If they did, I'd love to hear it. And if they didn't, I want to know why not. Right. Here's a man. Let me see. There's an email here. It says, do you have anything by Terry O'Neill? That's the gentleman I talked about earlier. Well, I mixed him up. He was the guy who played Christy Moore in that play by Brian Moore. He's also known as Cruncher. In particular, I would like to hear something off his album, Inextricably Linked, perhaps Irish Ways and Irish Laws, or Ruby Tuesday, or indeed Your Own Choice. I don't have that, but what we will do, we'll play something from, let me see, we'll play something from Christy Moore, actually, because any excuse at all, as far as I'm concerned, to play something by Christy Moore is always appropriate. Here's a gentleman, Peter Kerr. He said, I listened to your show a few weeks ago for the first time while staying at our estate in Saint-Tropez. That's just beside Poleglass, I do believe. I'm afraid that I retuned to your station because, although I am a Radio 4 addict, I cannot and will not listen to Woman's Hour. Sure, I once replaced Woman's Hour. Oh, he's on to mention that. I was also curious that the BBC would let you broadcast ever again, given your Radio 4 debacle. Oh, that was a long time ago. I've learned from that. I was, however, charmed and entertained, despite your accent, and quickly became a regular. Since returning to London, I am unable to access your show, and I have to say that I miss it. Well, you can access it, Peter Kerr, when you're not in your estate in Saint-Tropez, when you're in London beside Poleglass, or indeed Rathcoole. What you can do is you can get yourself a Sky digital thing and tune in to 868. Sorry, I always should say 968, which is the Playboy channel. 868 will find us there. You'll find us there. Or indeed on Freeview, 79 and 80. I know everything. Why do I know everything? Because I take the trouble to find it out. Hello.
Hello.
Yes, who's that?
Hello, this is Rosie Hayes speaking, Jerry.
Yes, Rosie.
I have a very sad story, and I would like your listeners maybe that somebody will be able to help me.
Okay.
My aunt, who is a pensioner, and her friend were robbed outside their place of worship last Sunday morning. They were sitting in the car park waiting for the church to open up, and they were approached by two persons, and their handbags were stolen.
They were sitting in the car?
Just sitting in the car. Actually, one of the persons got into the car with the ladies.
And you mean in the front seat or in the back?
In the back seat.
And
now,
reached
one
over.
Of the handbags was in the back and the other one was in the front.
God's sake.
But, yes, they have lost quite a bit of money. My aunt actually was going on holiday, and she was afraid to leave the money in the house.
Oh, dear.
And she took the money with her. But most importantly, she had her mother's wedding ring. It's a pink gold wedding band in the handbag.
Mm.
And she is totally devastated because the ring's gone.
Yeah.
Her holiday, she went on holiday, but her holiday, she's coming home today because she just...
She couldn't enjoy it.
No. And we were just wondering if there was maybe a jeweller's... Now, this is in the County Armagh area.
Yes.
And if there was a jeweller's that maybe has been offered this wedding ring or anybody that, you know, they've tried to sell this wedding ring on. It's quite a heavy gold plain band. And we would just love to get that wedding ring back.
No inscription or anything?
There's absolutely nothing on
right.
the ring.
Just a plain gold band?
Yes.
Pink gold, you said?
Pink gold band, perfectly plain, but quite heavy. It was an old, you know, it's her mother's, so you may guess.
But it's the real McCoy.
It's the real McCoy.
Yeah.
And my aunt didn't marry herself, and this ring was so important to her.
Wouldn't you think you'd be safe enough sitting in
yes.
your car outside your church, wouldn't you?
Yes, very much so. And like two pensioners, you know, just it just begs...
Beggar's description.
It's unbelievable.
I know.
And I would just like to say to anybody else out there, and I don't want to put the wind up anybody, but it seems this has been going on in the area. And just people be on their guard.
What is the area?
The area, where it actually happened was Vinnie Cash Presbyterian Church car park, a wee country church.
Not even in the city at all?
You would never, ever dream of a Jerry happening.
A wee country quiet church.
A wee country quiet church where a handful of people go to worship.
Well, you see, that's the very place where people would go because they'd never be caught.
Yeah.
Who's going to run after them?
And, you know, it's so sad when they have to attack elderly people.
Has this happened a number of times before?
Well, it seems that these particular people have been in the area.
My God.
So, we have walked the roads, and maybe you could put an appeal out to farmers in case they have cleared the bags and pitched
yeah.
the handbags over the fields.
And
we have walked the whole roads round the church looking the handbags. We've spent a couple of nights at it, you know. But maybe if it has been thrown over a hedge and a farmer comes, maybe working in the fields, come in the handbags.
Yeah. What do you call that wee place again?
It's spelt Vine Cash, VineCash, but it's pronounced Vinnie Cash.
And where's that near?
It's it's just about 3-4 miles outside Portadown.
Okay.
Going towards Loch Gall.
All right, okay, fair enough. Isn't that awful?
It's terrible, it really is, and I really feel for the two ladies, and I just hope that they both can recover quickly.
You, of course, you've told the police, of course.
Oh, yes, the police have been on the job, you know.
All
so
right.
We've done all we can, you know, but we just would like this wedding band back.
Okay, so we urge people to keep an eye out. You never know, they might have jettisoned the bag and maybe never seen the wedding.
They may not have seen it, you know. It's like a needle in a haystack, but we're trying everything we can
all
because
right,
it would mean so much to her.
It's obviously upsetting you a bit too.
Well, it was my granny. And she was very, I had lived with her and she was very precious to me. And to think that her wedding band has got into the wrong hands.
Well, don't you worry too much about it because worse things than that have happened.
Oh yes, very much so. I know it's only maybe a wedding ring, but it was special because the person was special.
Okay then. All right then. Thanks for your
Okay, Jerry. Thanks, you very, very much.
Okay,
thank
bye.
You now. Bye-bye.
Bye. There we are. There's a lady. Nice lady. Obviously a very decent, God-fearing lady. He's very upset. So if you know anything about that, don't hesitate to give us a ring or indeed the police. Hello, good morning. Hello.
Hello, sorry.
That's quite all right. I thought you hung up.
I didn't, know.
No, it had that sound about it. Anyway, not to worry.
You know what I'm looking, Jerry?
Yes.
A pair of stilts.
You're looking for a pair of stilts?
Yeah.
Right.
Can you help?
I've never been asked for a pair of stilts before.
Didn't think so.
Mm-hmm. I don't know what to say to you. Except, why?
Why?
Mm-hmm.
To help me with my job.
What is your job?
I'm a window cleaner.
I haven't seen this done before. There's an element of risk here. Why don't you use a ladder like any normal person?
Well, see, you could fall off a ladder just as much as you could fall off a pair of stilts.
The only thing about a ladder is there's rungs to hang on to. But see, when you fall off stilts, it's a long way down there.
I'm not going to fall off them.
Well, do you want stilts with shoes on them?
I don't care.
Have you had any training as a stilt walker?
Not yet.
Have you known any of your companions, any of your colleagues in the window cleaning business who have turned to the stilt for comfort?
Not yet.
Where did you get the idea? Obviously, seeing a stilt walker. And you said to yourself, but then again, you see, what are you going to do for the lower floors?
Once you get off stilts, you can go around and do them.
But see, you'd need adjustable stilts.
Not really, no.
You'd need ones that you can adjust. I mean, what's the point of you having stilts if you're 2 foot higher than you should be?
Well, I can get off the stilts and walk around and do the bottom ones.
And what about the top ones that aren't maybe as high as you think they should be? Supposing you get a first floor window that's maybe 8 feet up, right?
Yeah.
And your stilt's 8 feet, and you're between the stories. You need to have a ratchet there to adjust your stilt.
Well, I can use a ladder for them, but the majority...
Why don't you use a ladder for the whole lot?
You ever try it?
I fell off a ladder recently. My wife forced
there
me into
go.
Putting
now,
up...
If you hadn't been using the first belt, you mightn't have failed.
I fell off. I nearly did myself a serious injury. My wife made me do it. And she made me get up on this ladder and hammer a nail in the wall. I said, I'm not doing that. I said, that's your job. You're the wife. And she said, get up there like a man. So I fell for that. And I fell off the ladder and bounced off the baluster.
See, that's what I mean. If you had her pair of stilts, you wouldn't have failed.
I know, but you see, it wouldn't have occurred to me to wear stilts, yeah, to hammer in a nail in the wall. You've obviously been to the circus or two.
Oh, I've seen plasterers use them now. A lot.
Do they really?
On Bolton Sage, yeah.
Do they really?
Mm-hmm.
I didn't know that. I don't believe you.
You learn something new every day.
I don't believe you, though.
Well, somebody ring up and tell you, honey.
I've never seen a plasterer on stilts. Do they use... No, they don't.
They do.
Do you think... What do you think? I came up the foil in the bubble? That's what they say here.
They do use them now.
They don't.
It's convenient. For to do ceilings.
For to do ceilings.
For to do ceilings.
Mm. Hold on a second. I'm getting information here.
Thank God.
Yes. Really? Oh, my God. Is that right? My God. You're right.
Told you.
And do you know where you can buy them?
No.
Nuts Corner on a Sunday. the stalls, the DIY stalls, have them for plasters, stilts for plasters. Somebody just rang in and told us. You can get them on a Sunday at the Nuts Corner at the stalls.
Is that right?
Yeah, there you go.
See?
But you see, the plaster stilts may not be good for you. They may not have the elevation that you require.
Well, I can find out who makes them and get the bigger
ones. Get down to Nuts Corner on Sunday. Eh?
That's what I was going to say. I wonder who makes them.
I don't know. Maybe perhaps someone else could tell us. Why don't you just go down and look at them, for God's sake? You don't depend on me for everything.
Do you want a pair?
No, I don't. I'm okay.
See if you can up the ladder.
There's a set in this week's Auto Trader as well.
In the Auto Trader?
Uh-huh. Okay?
Okay, Jeff.
Right.
Thanks for your help.
Thank you. Goodbye.
Bye.
Goodbye. No, I've heard everything. Oh, no, I haven't heard anything. I've heard this, haven't heard this.
There's 28 counties in Ireland. There's Longford, Westmeath and Roscommon.
This is a classic.
Oh, Listil Barna.
Many requests for this, to play the whole thing. There's a little risque language in this, but I apologise in advance. If you don't like it, don't listen.
Listil, 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 Listil Barna.
How's it going there, everybody from Cork, New York, and Dofgur to Hark and Glenamaddy? Here we are in the County Clare, and it's a long, long way from here to there. There's the Burren, there's the Cliffs of Moher, and there's the Tuller, and there's the Kilfenore, and there's Mike O'Russell, Dr. Bill, Willie Clancy, and Noel Hale, and flutes and fiddles everywhere. If it's music you want, up the banner!
I have to say at this point that all black taxis are all legal, PSV'd and insured, so do not be alarmed. I was talking earlier about the fact that there was a time years ago when they weren't, but they all are now.
Everybody needs a break. Climb a mountain or jump in the lake. Some head off to exotic places and others go to the Galway race. Matty goes to the south of France and Jim to the dogs and Peter to the dance. A cousin of mine goes pot holing. A cousin of hers loves Joe Dolan. As the summer comes around each year, well, we go there and they come here. And some jet off to Frihilliana, but me and Don and Declan, we always head down there. We go right down, get down, get down. Well, I normally the leave of a Thursday night, but my tent and my ground sheet are all the tight. I like to hit Listil in around Friday afternoon, cause
This gives me time to get my tent up, get my gear together. I don't need to worry about the weather. I can ramble in for a pint of stout. You never know who'd be hanging about. There's the Dutchman playing a mandolin, and there's a German looking for a Liam O'Flynn. Adam and Bono and Larry and the Edge getting a photo taken with Naomi. Finbar, Charlie and Jim Hand, and the drinking pints to bait the bandit. Why wouldn't they, for Jesus' sake, aren't they getting it for nothing? The multitudes, they flocked in throngs to hear the music and the songs. Motorbikes and high-ace vans with bottles, barrels, flagons, cans, the mighty crack, loads of frolics, pioneers and alcoholics, and Clack and Spook and the FCA, Free Nicky Kelly and the IRA, hairy chests and milk-white ties and Mickey Dodgers in disguise, McGrath's, O'Brien's, Pippin's, Cox's, massage parlors and horse boxes, RTE are making tapes and taking breaks and throwing shapes, Aurons and Baurons and Amadons and hairy freaks and Arab sheiks and Hindu Sikhs and Jesus freaks, and this is heaven and this is hell, and who cares, or who can tell him? Anyway, for the last few shock eyes, before we go. For Jackson Brown to build a special run, but just to get him down, and before the chieftains could start to play, there was six creamy pints come out in a tray. Sean Cannon was doing the backstage cooking, and Shergar was written by Lord Lucan. Mary O'Hare and the Brush Shields together singing the Four Green Fields, and Cannon were playing Harry's Game, and Chris de Burgh was singing Lady in Red in the Spanish Train, and Van de Man was going, turn it up. Me mad when I go home. The boys won't play, the girls alone. The woman my hair, stole my comb. But that's all right, let me go home. She is handsome, she is pretty. She is the belle of Belfast. She is curt in 1, 2, 3. Please, won't you tell me who is she? And oh, the listed man. Oh yeah, the listed man. Everybody needs a break. Climb a mountain or jump in the lake. Sean Doherty goes to the Rose of Tralee, and Oliver J. Flanagan, God be good to me, used to go swimming bullet naked in the Holy Sea. But we prefer music in the open air, so every summer we do head down there to Clare, because Woodstock, nor knock. Nor Freddie Mercury and Slane, the Jazz, nor the HQ, nor Liberty Hall, nor fucking none of them.
That's Christy Moore, Liston Varner, from an album called Live at Vicar Street. If you don't like that, check your pulse. We'll be back on Monday at the same time, 10:30. If you want to write to me, write to Gerry Anderson, care of BBC Radio Foyle, 8 Northland Road, Derry, Stoke, Londonderry. Have a nice weekend. Keep it safe. Drive carefully. Goodbye.